Sure.
Okay, welcome to this episode of the Athletic Fitness and Nutrition Podcast. My name is Paul Burgess, and I'm here today with Susan Masino, if I pronounce that right,
yes.
Who is Professor of Applied Science at Trinity College, Connecticut. Susan, thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you. It's wonderful to be here with you, Paul.
I know we've had lots of email exchanges back and forth for a few months, and we eventually got a time together, which has been brilliant. And the reason I've asked Susan to come on is because there's been a lot of research from her perspective on metabolism, brain health, the effect of lifestyle on how we function properly, and so on and so forth. And that to me is a huge, huge personal interest. So Susan, tell us more about, it's going to be difficult because it's been like 20 odd years that you've been doing it, but tell us a bit about your history and the kind of areas that you've been specializing in.
Yeah, so I've been interested in the relationship between metabolism and brain function since I started in the field as a graduate student. And as a tiny brief history, I became interested in how small non-pathological physiological stresses affected our brain and how our ability to adapt to those small stresses might be related to how our brains can learn. And I looked at small stresses like temperature, free radicals, pH, kind of evolutionarily fundamental forces that cells were exposed to in the, you know, primordial soup, if you want to call it. And that led me to work on adenosine, which is a very fundamental molecule, which is also the core of ATP, our energy molecule. So my work on adenosine and ATP, to make a long story short, led me to a hypothesis that the metabolic change that occurs with a ketogenic diet might increase adenosine, and that those changes could be very beneficial in reducing seizures and preventing or reversing other types of neurological disorders like autism. So my main work in my lab is on pain, epilepsy, and autism. I've also done a little bit of work on Huntington's disease. But my real passion is on brain health and how to keep our incredible adaptable brains as healthy and adaptable as possible for as long as possible.
So does that mean that the higher your adenosine level, the more your brain's going to function better? Or is that too simplistic?
I think it's a little too simplistic because there's some adenosine around all the time. So it's almost something you can kind of dial up or dial down. If you have way too much adenosine, you will basically fall asleep or just go into a coma. So too much is not good. But there's a lot of mechanisms to regulate how much adenosine there is. And adenosine is regulated developmentally over your lifespan and regulated by these forces that I was talking about, regulated by seizures, regulated by oxygen deprivation, regulated by exercise. So it's something that's a constant dynamic force and a link between your energy status and your brain activity.
So the bottom line was, we're trying to find out how do we get the best brain activity, the best functioning brain, and your research led you to the use of a ketogenic diet for some reason. Now, I think I know what the underlying mechanism is for that, but just explain why you went that route and not potentially something like the standard high carb, low fat route or some other sort of intervention.
Well, it's a little bit of a accidental discovery because I wasn't initially interested in diet at all. I had a number of manipulations I was doing in brain tissue, like pH, temperature, etc. And I found that all the things that seemed to release adenosine, certain receptor activations, were all associated with a decrease in intracellular pH. And ketone-based metabolism generates more protons than glucose-based metabolism, just as a simple principle. So I started saying, okay, well, are there any conditions with decreased pH that might be also associated with symptoms of increased adenosine. So I was thinking initially about sleep. I wasn't even thinking about seizures. So I've been just kind of mulling about these ideas for a while, and I found out that a ketogenic diet, which promotes ketone-based metabolism, is very profoundly anticonvulsant. And it works in cases where medications fail. And adenosine is also an incredibly powerful anticonvulsant and will work in cases where medications fail. It will stop any kind of a seizure. And I realized they didn't know how the ketogenic diet worked. And we've been trying for many, many decades to figure out how to take advantage of adenosine's potential as a neuroprotective molecule in terms of recovering from brain injury and its anticonvulsant potential in treating seizures. So adenosine was kind of a holy grail in neuroscience. We knew it had so much potential, but it was so powerful and it would put you to sleep if you had too much of it. And peripherally, if you had too much adenosine, it would stop your heart. So this is not an acceptable side effect of a pharmacological agent. So it's just been a very challenging, an incredibly important but very challenging molecule to regulate. So I've been trying to think, is there a way we could regulate adenosine specifically in the brain to take advantage of these properties and avoid the peripheral side effects and regulate it in a way where we wouldn't get into having too much adenosine and, you know, neurological side effects. So that's how I got into working on the ketogenic diet, which is kind of a very, you know, unusual route into this whole line of research, which has now become entirely the main focus of my lab.
And so using a ketogenic diet, that will be self-regulating then. I'm guessing you're not going to get too much adenosine floating around because your body's going to regulate that.
Right, naturally. Right. I guess, you know, the thing about the diet is you can't dose it like a drug, which is good because you can't overdose.
Yeah.
But the other thing is if you have a pathological condition that's too severe or, you know, depending on what the mechanisms are, the diet might not, you know, might not be able to reverse you to health. It might be able to have some benefits, but not get you all the way to normal. So it's kind of a double-edged sword. You can't overdose on it, but you might not be able to fully treat a condition.
Okay. So interestingly, about 2 years ago, I made a comment that said, the ketogenic diet is going to be the next big thing simply because exogenous supplements, so ketone supplements, had been produced and approved, and there will have to be a market for them, and therefore people will start creating this market and start talking about, you know, you can get into ketosis in 15 minutes by taking some ketone salts, which is actually nonsense. It doesn't work, obviously. You can have ketones in your system, but it does not mean you're in ketosis. So most people will know the ketogenic diet for weight loss because that's what they want, right? They want fast weight loss or fat loss. And it's very much touted for that. And listeners of this show will know that we've spoken about keto multiple times and it's different varying benefits. But I'm really interested that your research has got nothing to do with weight or fat loss or anything like that whatsoever. It's purely about how do we get the brain to function optimally. And personally, I know that when I've used a ketogenic diet, my brain function is so much better, much clearer. Like now, this is the 3rd today of January 2017, and over the last 2 weeks, I have eaten a lot of sugar. It's been Christmas, it's been New Year, and I've come off a ketogenic diet and really been ridiculous in the amount of rubbish that I've eaten. Yesterday and the day before, I felt awful. Like, you just know, you're just tired, no motivation, brain fog, you know, the focus on anything is like less than 5 minutes. And you feel as though everything is real inflamed and it's a massive problem. And I know exactly why it was. And it's absolutely fine because from today, everything's back to as it should be, back on the diet that I much prefer. But it's hugely interesting how very quickly things can change for the worse as well as the better.
Yeah.
So in your studies, what sort of kind of timescales were you seeing improvements for people?
Yeah, well, I don't work with, I've only done very limited clinical collaboration, so I mostly work with rats and mice.
Okay.
So it's very easy to control what they're eating. They don't celebrate Christmas or yeah. Hanukkah, New Year. So I typically have been applying the diet for 3 weeks, and I started that based on what other people had published in terms of anticonvulsant effects with epilepsy. But I've also done diet manipulations of 10 weeks or even a bit longer. And one of the reasons why I've been doing that is we've been seeing some long-term effects of diet administration that persisted even after we reverted the diet back to a control diet. So this is an attempt to try and look at the long-term epigenetic effects that the diet may be able to promote in a number of different neurological conditions, particularly epilepsy, autism, and pain are the three that I'm interested in right now. And I think that this is an important point. With epilepsy, they found that within a month, many, many, many children will have their seizures massively reduced within just a few days. About 90% will have a significant impact within a month. But if the diet doesn't work in 3 months, it's probably not going to work. So there is kind of a, you know, I feel like this is an important message for people to get if they are thinking about trying the diet for a neurological condition. You can try it for a certain amount of time and you should see some benefits, and that may be motivation to keep going. If it's a child, they may see some benefits that are able to outlast even going off the diet 6 months or a year or 2 years later. And that's what's been found with a lot of kids with epilepsy. And the other reason why I think this timescale question is so important is these, just like we can't dose it like you can dose with a pill, a neurological disorder doesn't come on overnight. So why would you expect using your own physiology to be able to reverse it overnight? It doesn't make any sense. We need to kind of recalibrate our expectations of using our endogenous physiology to reverse these changes in accordance with, you know, maybe with an analogy to weight loss. You didn't gain all the weight overnight. You need to have a similar time frame to lose the weight.
Okay, so the improvement, and this is my poor understanding of it, and I'm very happy to be shot down in flames, but the improvement I'm assuming is coming from a reduction in inflammatory issues within the brain from potentially overloads of glucose and that kind of thing, and gluten potentially, those sort of parameters. What's your thoughts? Am I on the right track?
I think you're on the right track, and I think there's a number, this is the beauty of a dietary change. There's a lot of different mechanisms that it can mobilize, and I think as scientists, we haven't really figured out which ones are really the key ones and what amount of impact each mechanism has, and maybe for different disorders, different mechanisms may be more fundamental. Let's say for epilepsy, for example, I think the increase in adenosine is very important, at least initially, in stopping the seizures, and probably the anti-inflammatory effects. The anti-inflammatory effects have a lot of kind of long-term, you know, cellular benefits. And we think adenosine is both has anticonvulsant effects and anti-epileptogenic effects to actually decrease DNA methylation. And that's kind of what this epigenetic change is what can help to reverse the disease state.
Okay. So then when we're looking at a ketogenic diet to produce ketones, so the brain runs off of that. There's a small amount of glucose it will produce anyway because it will want to just, I think it's about 20%, 25% or something of the day's turnover. We're then also looking at gut health from a ketogenic point of view because you're going to take out the legumes, grains, dairy, that kind of stuff. I mean, I say dairy only because I don't eat dairy, but a lot of ketogenic diets are based around butter and cream and stuff. But a lot of the things that will naturally cause inflammatory response in your body are taken away. And we again are reducing inflammation from that perspective. Do you think that's going to have that kind of double effect? The fact that it's producing ketones and it's reducing the inflammatory irritants?
Yes. definitely. And just to relate that specifically, let's say to autism, because you mentioned gut health.
Yeah.
And there's often a lot of GI comorbidity with autism, constipation, or, you know, very restricted dietary interests. A researcher, Thanasios Evangeliou in Greece, who did the first kind of small prospective study of ketogenic diet and autism using kind of an unusual protocol. I spoke to him recently, and he said with kids with autism, that he's been treating with the ketogenic diet, if they're very young kids, he can put them on kind of a metabolic approach and has a lot of benefits. But if they're older, he needs to kind of fix their gut health before he can apply a diet and help to improve their symptoms of autism. So the whole gut health thing is, you know, almost like your gateway to having your diet be able to improve your health. If your gut health is bad, then you're kind of stuck.
Yeah, even trying to use a ketogenic diet, if you've still got inflammatory response going on in your gut, it's still going to cause problems, right?
Well,
potentially.
It really hasn't been. Yeah, potentially. There could be a need to improve your gut health to be able to have a diet, improve your overall neurological health and, yeah, and other aspects of health.
Okay, so from a neurological health point of view, this is interesting for me personally. Okay, so as we get older, we kind of forget things,
yeah,
apparently. Okay, so one, I want to know, why do we forget things as we get older? Because clearly we've got more stuff to remember, so surely we should remember it more, not forget it more. And let's say there was somebody talking to you at the end of a Skype call who couldn't remember things as well as you'd like to. What would be potentially your thoughts on how people can improve their daily memory from what you know?
Well, this isn't really the focus of my research, but I'll tell you some strategies that I think kind of anybody could implement. I'm a big fan of coconut oil. So as a way to eat more MCT oil that's readily available in most markets now. You've probably talked about this with other people on the show. It's a good oil to cook with. They have now some liquid flavorless forms that have even a higher MCT content. So I would recommend that.
Susan. So would you be looking at caprylic acid specifically or the full spectrum of MCTs that come in that?
Oh, I just buy the regular
just the MCT.
Coconut oil. Okay. Yeah. It's affordable, you know, you can't really overdose on it. And, you know, it's kind of maybe closer to a natural thing. So I'm not really a brain hacker per se.
Yeah.
I go for like inexpensive, practical things.
Yeah.
The other thing I would say is try and do what you can to take advantage of the habit part of your brain. So okay, if you can, whatever you can kind of relegate to training yourself is habits, helps you to save your creativity and your memory storage for things. And I can say this personally because I'm the kind of stereotypical person who's like, where's my keys? You know, something like that. So I need to even myself improve some habit type strategies so that you can save your evolutionarily evolved part of your brain for more important things. So I would recommend that. And sleep is so important.
Yeah.
So what we've realized, it's not really for rest. That is when your brain is essentially clearing out waste. And I think also maybe clearing out unimportant information, little tidbits of information that you get during the day. And so really put a priority on good sleep, because sleep deprivation has terrible metabolic effects, mental health effects, you know, the list goes on and on. So, I mean, exercise, of course, is always important. And a good diet is important, too. Some studies from Europe have shown that you eat a poor diet, you have more anxiety and depression, you have poorer mental health. You eat a good diet, you don't have those problems. So any kind of anxiety, depression, or kind of you know, maybe even not diagnosed clinically, but that gets your brain going in ways where you're thinking about other things, and you're cluttering up your brain with things that you don't need to be thinking about.
I totally agree. I think when you're not eating as well as you should do, just your mood is different. And right. you won't even know why. You know, right. I'll just, and people go through their life like that. So they go, oh, I always feel like this. It's just normal. Whereas right. other people look at them and go, why have you got no zest for life? Why are you not enthusiastic about things? And go, well, nothing excites me really. And go, well, there's a reason for that. You know,
right.
and I think you notice a huge difference when your brain is functioning well, you can focus, you've got enthusiasm for a task. And that, from my experience personally, is absolutely directly related to what I eat or not eat. So, for example, if I tend to fast in the morning and I get most of my good work done in the morning when it comes to either writing or strategizing something or doing an interview or whatever else it is, it works much better for me when I haven't eaten.
Mm-hmm.
And if it's, especially if it's the end of a fast, you tend to be a lot more, you have a lot more clarity.
Mm-hmm.
And what I kind of developed over a period of time is that, so if I want to keep that going, either I can continue to fast or take in some, it happens to be caprylic acid for me, which bumps up the ketone production. And again, that works, or take some exogenous ketones because they kind of give you that little bump as well. And I find that just from a mental perspective works really well. But, and I know it's not your speciality, but I'd love to get your thoughts on it. I've used ketone esters before.
Mm-hmm.
And whilst they are phenomenal for performance, once they wear off, they absolutely send me into the most tired state you can imagine. Like literally within 2 minutes, you can be on top of the world and then all of a sudden you just feel like you've got to go to sleep. Kind of almost like a crash. And I found that very, very interesting. It didn't get so much with the salts because they didn't bump your ketones up so high. But with an ester, I could get up to like 4.5, 5 millimolar. And when it ran out, if you like, it stopped very abruptly. But in the while I was using it, the brain function was phenomenal.
That's interesting. I'm not sure why that is, but I'm just a fan overall of, how much diet can improve your metabolic resilience. And I think that an exogenous supplement like that isn't really able to provide that, foundation of metabolic resilience that a diet can. So that might be why you're able to, like other drugs, you have like a certain window of dosing. Yeah. And then there's always the withdrawal effect, crash.
And I sort of had the same experience when in the first 6 months of being ketogenic, I was performance-wise in my chosen sport, pastime, whatever you want to call it, I was rubbish because it's a very glycolytically demanding, glucose-demanding event. And I sucked at it so badly. And it took about 6 months for my mitochondria, if you like, to adapt to burning fat well and to even get back to where I was previous to that. And I definitely think if people jump in too quickly with exogenous ketones and are still taking in a lot of glucose and so on, it may well help from a short performance point of view. But like you say, unless you've got that underlying structure in place that knows what to do with it and how to use it properly, I think it can definitely cause you some challenges later on when it's finished.
Right. Well, and that addresses kind of the time course issue that we were talking about as well, is you have to have some expectation of the time course that it takes to build up this metabolic resilience and take advantage of it. And I think it's important to be really self-aware of your physical and mental health, so that you can be self-aware of the changes that are happening, and that will be motivation to continue pursuing it. The other thing I just wanted to mention about brain health is I'm a really big fan of trying to spend time outdoors and, in nature, get away from all the clutter. And, you know, even if it's in a park or, you know, most people have access to some kind of outdoor space, get away from your devices, get outside and let your brain breathe a little bit and get away from all the noise of everyday life. And I think that really can have a big benefit for mental health and also memory, because it helps you to kind of refocus.
And you know what I find? You're absolutely right. You know, I can look out of my window now and I can see greenery, and, you know, I'm within a 5-minute drive, I'd say, to a very large woodland and whatnot. And I do spend time there when I get the chance. But we kind of put it right at the bottom of a list of things to go and do because we are so busy doing other stuff that we think so important. And we kind of forget how important that is, because if we're looking at an evolutionary point of view, that never had to be put on a list because that's where they were. Right? That was it.
Right.
And we've then become ever so civilized and intelligent and found out we can build structures which are heated and watertight, and, you know, we're able to stay in safely and not get attacked by things, and forget that actually being outside is actually a pretty good thing for a lot of us.
Yeah. Well, I think our big brains are both a blessing and a curse in terms of, you know, where we're going.
You can't say that we're the most advanced we've ever been and yet have simultaneous epidemics of famine and obesity. There's got to be something wrong there, right?
Right, yeah.
I know you've done, well, maybe no, not you, but you've had experience with people who've had other metabolic diseases, and I'm going to call cancer a metabolic disease. And we still hear a lot about the battle with cancer, how people are still, you know, dying very young from it and so on and so forth. And yet there's also been a lot of research that is showing using a ketogenic diet, certainly a very low glucogenic approach, really helps, because a lot of tumors and a lot of cancers thrive on the glucose. And I'm not a specialist in this in any way, but I've got some knowledge of it. So firstly, ketogenic diet for someone who is looking to try and improve their cancer therapy, good or bad?
For most cancers, I think it probably would be beneficial. And they're the most evidence that we have right now is for brain cancer. I think there's something like 9 trials going on right now on ketogenic diet as an add-on therapy for a number of different cancers. You can look at clinicaltrials.gov and see what's going on. And so to even mobilize a clinical trial, there's usually, you know, significant proof of concept kind of evidence to even start a clinical trial. So that right there is evidence that there's thought to be some benefits. A personal friend of mine just had a very positive experience with lung cancer, an aggressive lung cancer. And she was barely a surgical candidate, which surgery is really your best chance for a cure with lung cancer. And that was because of the size of her tumor. And she went on the ketogenic diet right away. Didn't want to get the surgery, which made me extremely nervous because I was afraid the tumor was going to grow to the point where she would no longer be offered surgery as an option. So I felt like she was really taking a risk. But she said, you know, it's my health and it's my decision. And she's not a ketogenic diet researcher or anything. So as someone who cared about her very much, this made me nervous, but I felt, well, you know, she's doing all the right things. She's keeping track of everything. She did it extremely carefully. And she did the diet for 6 months. The tumor didn't grow at all. It was initially, they said it was wrapped around her trachea. They were going to have to take out her trachea, disassemble it, and like reattach it or something. It sounded horrible. Take out 2 lobes and that she would need additional therapy. And it turned out that they were able to take out the tumor, didn't touch her trachea, took out 1 lobe, and she's just had a phenomenal outcome. So I know that's only one person, but that's the problem, is it's very hard to advocate more widely for the diet because doctors aren't aware of it. There aren't the kind of gold standard, prospective, phase three, you know, placebo-controlled studies that are done for all the different...
Was she taking any other medication for that? Was she being treated in any other way for the cancer, or she just did it on her diet?
She did the diet for about 3 months, and then she added on hyperbaric treatments.
Right.
She rented a hyperbaric chamber, put it in her apartment, and she was also doing some Chinese herbs. I'm not sure exactly what. She's an acupuncturist, so that was kind of her thing that she added, and she did a pectin that I think people do with cancer to try and reduce sort of the stickiness of the cancer and its ability to migrate and metastasize. So those are the four main things: the diet, the hyperbaric, the pectin, and the Chinese herbs, I think, are the main things.
So no standard of care, no
nothing.
Chemo, no radiation, nothing like that. Interesting. And it's not the first, you know, it's not the first time I've heard cases like that where people have really benefited from having a ketogenic diet when they've got that kind of issue.
Right.
And like you say, doctors don't understand it enough.
Right.
There certainly isn't. It's difficult. You know, how do you say, right, okay, we're going to trial this with 1,000 people all suffering this metabolic disease and just see what happens? Because a lot of them are going to be saying, well, I'm not really that keen on being the guinea pig for that.
Right.
But then if we go back and look at things like chemo and radiotherapy, there must have been trials for that of a similar vein. So it's a shame we can't move it onto a more natural approach. I think one of the issues is you can't charge for a ketogenic diet the way you can for a medical treatment.
Right. I mean, you can charge for it. There are codes now that you can charge for in the system, but it's definitely not as lucrative as all the, or easily administered as all these expensive cancer drugs. And I think that reason, what you're saying, is the, you know, the ethical issue of saying, well, we're just going to try a diet. We have all these other drugs. We're just going to try a diet, might be challenging to mobilize, but that's why they're trying it in addition to standard of care.
Okay, so if someone doesn't have a health issue or potentially doesn't have a brain issue at the moment or epilepsy or anything like that, where would you put your opinion on a good all-round diet for somebody to follow that's going to keep them healthy, give them good longevity, good brain function, that kind of thing? Do they have to go to the extreme of being ketogenic? Because that can be quite difficult to stick to a lot of the time.
I mean, I'm not on a ketogenic diet, but I've definitely made my diet lower carbohydrate over time. I have a big family history of diabetes. I probably could almost be classified as like borderline pre-diabetic right now. I've been testing my blood sugar for the past year and a half to try and keep an eye on it. I mean, both sides of my family, everybody has diabetes. It's really striking. I should get some genetic testing. And they all seem to get it by the time they're 55. And, you know, if you're diagnosed with it at 55, it's been brewing for a while before that. And I'm 50 right now. So I'm just trying to keep an eye on that. So I would say definitely focus on healthy fats. And for that, I would say coconut oil, butter, buy good quality grass-fed if you can. Good quality olive oil would be kind of the three main healthy fats that are easily purchased by most people. Healthy protein, you know, wild-caught fish, grass-fed beef if you can get it, good eggs, other meats, organ meats if you can get it, which is not really accessible to most people.
We get great liver over here.
Yeah.
And it's crazy because in one of our big supermarkets, they sell New Zealand lamb's liver, which generally 95% of it from New Zealand is all grass-fed because they've got so much grass there, they've got no reason to feed them anything else.
Right.
And it's for nothing. Literally, like 500 grams is like less than $2 over there.
Wow.
Right. And but no one wants it. That's the trouble.
Right.
And it's amazing. It's just the greatest stuff. And if it's cooked properly, then it's fantastic.
Well, yeah, so I've realized that also. That's what I've been buying in the supermarket the past few years is the New Zealand lamb, because you realize it's grass-fed, but it's not priced like grass-fed beef or something like that is. So that's like a little secret. So then I see the lamb that says USA raised. I'm like, well, I'm going to get the New Zealand one because sure, pretty sure that one's grass-fed. Yeah, so that's a great option. And then vegetables, you know, try and focus on the non-starchy vegetables. Obviously, limited potatoes and corn. Focus on greens, cruciferous vegetables, you know, berries for fruits, and just try and shift your diet toward lower glycemic index foods, healthy fats, healthy protein. Of course, you know, definitely limit all the refined stuff. That's, I mean, it's kind of a simple whole food diet approach. And I think the majority of people would see improvement in their health if they ate that. I mean, some people are more tolerant to eating a poor diet than other people, or more, I guess, able to function well and feel good even if they eat poorly. Usually those people are younger. You seem to notice eating a poor diet affects you more as you get older, just like you notice, like, I can't stay up all night, you know, multiple nights in a row, or stay up till 2, 3 o'clock in the morning anymore. So that's really what I would recommend.
It's really interesting how many people just say, look, eat a whole food diet, which is low in carbohydrate, and that kind of ticks all the boxes and will give you the best chance of being healthy for as long as possible, least amount of inflammation, best brain function, this and that. But yeah, everybody kind of keeps repeating the same message over and over again, and yet it's still so foreign to so many people. And there's nothing special about it. There's no secret to it, really. Stop eating crap, eat what we're supposed to eat, buy your food for, that's whole food. Don't buy loads of processed stuff and you'll be fine. But people like the convenience. They want to be able to grab something really quickly because they haven't got time to sit down and eat, because that would be sacrilege, because then they wouldn't be able to either rush to their next appointment or watch that program on TV or whatever they had to do. And it's just crazy to me how we've got ourselves into this cultural place where it causes so many problems and yet it can be fixed so easily.
Well, I think we need better public policy messaging and public education about it. I think that there's this idea of like, we don't want to tell people what to eat. It's like, well, maybe we should, you know, there's a broad consensus now about the types of things that we're talking about. And I think we should spread that message a little bit more widely, not to make people feel badly, but to give people who are interested in the information, the information.
Yeah.
That, you know, you
Educate
might.
them from school upwards. Stop nonsense about this. You have to read it on the internet or seek it out somewhere in a book or whatever else it is. Get into the schools and start saying, look, this is the best way to eat. This is what's going to keep you healthier for longer. Understand it, ingrain it from a young age, like they do in Italy, for example. Go to Italy and the 3-year-olds know what an artichoke is. You do that over, even over here, you do that and kids will look at it and go, what is that? They've no idea. So getting it in from a young age and getting people to understand it, I think, is that's got to be somewhere to go. But you try getting that into the educational system.
Well, that's why I feel like my real passion is brain health. Because people might say, well, you know, maybe I weigh a few pounds more or less, or maybe I might get Alzheimer's disease in X number of years, and that's not really something that's going to motivate me today. But I think feeling like my brain would be working better, or my child's brain would be working better, is a real motivating factor. And just as a little bit related to that, just to harken back to what we were talking about with epilepsy and autism. You know, autism has so many different causes. We don't really know what causes autism, but we know it's a whole zoo of probably different genes and environmental factors, etc. In my lab, I've studied several different models of autism, and the ketogenic diet has benefits with every single one, whether it's a genetically determined type of autism or one that's environmentally determined. So improving your diet has broad-based effects no matter what's going on.
I'm really interested to go back to your blood glucose.
Yeah.
That you're measuring. What numbers are you showing at the moment?
Well, so fasting, I would say in the morning, maybe between 94 and 105.
Okay. So that's not terrible.
It's not terrible, but, you know, and then let's say if I eat pizza and a test a couple hours later, it could go up to like 140, 150, something like that.
And then, interestingly, then does it go below the 94 that you would have tested for in the morning? So in other words, how's your glucose clearance?
I don't know if it goes, it doesn't, I've never tested it below like 86 or something like that.
Okay. And so when does it test at 86? What's the circumstance?
In the morning it's been 86, or even in the evening sometimes it's been 86.
That's really good though.
It's good, but I've just noticed, so I've been using my husband as a comparison. So he doesn't have any diabetic history in his family. And let's say for breakfast, he has pancakes with maple syrup. And I have like 2 fried eggs in butter. My glucose could be like 120 something. And his is 78.
Yeah.
So clearly I'm much more sensitive to carbohydrate than he is.
Okay. So again, no, could talk about this for hours, but there was some research done last year in Israel. Are you aware of it? Where they looked at the gut microbiome of a large population of participants, and they found that some people will, depending on what their microbiome profile was like, obviously, will eat pancakes and get a huge insulin spike, and others would eat exactly the same and get a drop in insulin. And it was very, obviously, it's a very individual thing. They're starting to do some trials in the States now. The company is called day2.com. They're looking to do some clinical trials out there. I think you can pre-order the test out there as well. Can't get it over here at the moment. And they basically ran 24-hour blood glucose monitoring, and everything was written down, what people were eating, and they would just take their numbers. So what they're doing now is they're taking a stool test and saying, okay, this is the bacteria we find that's been in your gut, and they literally are able to turn around and say, this is what you should eat, and this is potentially when you should eat when it comes to glucose manipulation or controlling your blood glucose. So it's a really interesting next step. We do a lot of testing, DNA testing, bloods, intolerance, IgG4, that kind of stuff. But this is kind of the next thing now. Science is very new, you know, literally within the last 12 months, maybe 18 months. But still, no doubt, as soon as it's available, I'll get tested, because it will just be interesting. But yeah, so that's definitely something worth looking into. Do you ever use any supplements to try and improve glucose disposal in your cells and stuff? Anything like cinnamon or alpha lipoic acid?
You know, I've dabbled a little bit with cinnamon. Like I said, I'm not really a hacker, a physiology hacker. Yeah. The things I've taken are vitamin D, magnesium, and probiotic.
Right.
So those are kind of the three things. I'm sort of a minimalist with stuff like that. But, you know, cinnamon, I've been giving that to family members with diabetes to try and give them some benefits. So I've been thinking about trying the cinnamon and doing the, you know, before, after testing, after taking cinnamon before a meal and see that. So that's kind of my New Year's thing, is to do a little bit more of this self-experimentation, because I really think this whole era of self-experimentation is really exciting. The people are more aware of their health, and we're more aware of the science, and people are able to, the public is incredibly well informed, a certain population of the public, and they're almost leading the science in some ways, like, hey, we've been doing this, and then the scientists are like, oh, I can test that in my lab. So
let's find out why that's happening. The other thing worth putting in a list of things to try maybe will be apple cider vinegar.
Oh, yeah, I have that.
Before bed.
Yes, that's a good idea.
So see what happens if you take it before bed on your morning glucose.
Okay. Interesting. That's a good idea.
Because a lot of people will take it before a meal, potentially to reduce the insulin impact of the meal. Now, I'm not massively, I'm not 100% aware of the mechanism, but I do know apple cider vinegar in itself will increase stomach acid, or the production of stomach acid. And the production of stomach acid will allow you to break down foods better, especially proteins, and then potentially you'll absorb it better in your gut, and therefore you won't have such a gut irritant issue going on. That can push up cortisol, which can in turn push up blood glucose. So potentially that could be the chain of events that happens. But if you take it at night, after you've eaten and so on and so forth, so before bed, it also has quite a good effect on gut microbiome.
Right.
And facilitating that environment. And that in itself could be something that helps reduce morning blood glucose, because the microbiome is more, the fauna, if you like, is more robust. So it's interesting.
That's really interesting. I, I just published this book on ketogenic diet on a number of disorders and research on health and disease. And the research on microbiome wasn't really, I did invite one person who is kind of the real leader in microbiome, and they weren't interested in contributing a chapter to this edition, but we're already talking about a new version of the book for the 100th anniversary of the ketogenic diet. And I definitely want to feature, I'm already making a list of topics to include in the next edition. So the microbiome will definitely be on there, because papers are starting to come out. There's one on autism specifically on microbiome and ketogenic diet. So,
and it's so individual. That's the thing, you've got trillions of cells in the body, and everybody is so different. And that's why somebody's husband can eat pancakes for breakfast and have a 78 blood glucose, and someone else can eat the same thing and have 120. And once you know what works and what doesn't work for people, but what's interesting is even foods that you'd think are blanket the same throughout, take a banana, high glucose, rapid releasing, everyone's surely going to react the same way. They still found that some people will eat that and get a drop in blood glucose.
Mm.
And that just really makes people think, because you're looking at things and saying, okay, where's the commonality in any of this? If everybody's different to a banana, and then other people at the other end of the scale would have chickpeas and get a rise in blood glucose, which you think you'd need to be a blooming detective to find a raise in any blood glucose on a chickpea, but they're finding
that. This will be the new era, hopefully, in obesity treatment. Instead of getting a bariatric surgery, could you get this more personalized information on your microbiome and what you could eat, and not get your stomach stapled?
Absolutely. But and there's no value in getting your stomach stapled anyway. It hasn't solved the problem.
Yes,
you've got obese because you've eaten too many calories. Yeah, all right, we get that. But if you keep eating the same type of calories, you're still going to have the same underlying health issues. You're just going to have more frustration because you're not going to be able to eat as much. Right. And we're now seeing, bariatric surgery realistically became popular 10, 15 years ago. And we are now seeing people who've had them 8, 10 years putting weight back on.
Right.
So now where do we go? We've already taken away 3/4 of your stomach. You can only eat small amounts, and now you're putting weight on. What do we do? Right? So it isn't a cure-all by any... Anyway, I'll go off on a rant about that if I let myself. So tell us a bit more about the book, because that only came out recently, right? I remember getting the pre-order for that, actually, and it being sent to me to have a look at by Dominic D'Agostino.
Oh, nice.
I remember him promoting it, because I think he's contributed to it as well.
Yes, he's one of the section editors. There's 4 section editors, Dominic D'Agostino, Eric Kossoff, who's very well known for epilepsy and the ketogenic diet at Johns Hopkins. He's an MD. Jong Ro, who's an MD, he's at Calgary now, but he used to be in Phoenix and in Seattle. And he's involved in epilepsy, but also is doing a lot in autism now. And also Detlev Boisson, who's one of my close collaborators on adenosine. And we've also collaborated on the adenosine and ketogenic diet work. So the title is Ketogenic Diet and Metabolic Therapies, Expanded Roles in Health and Disease. So it covers ketogenic diet per se, but it also talks about ketone esters. It talks about using alternative strategies like 2-deoxyglucose as a way to substitute for and lower glucose metabolism. There's been a lot of talk in the research field, you know, is it the ketones? Is it the glucose? Is it both? You know, what are some of the key metabolic changes? And then what are the downstream mechanisms? So a lot of the book is talking about different mechanisms that might be underlying the effects of the diet, potassium channels, reactive oxygen species, etc. So there's a whole laboratory basic research section. There's a section on the latest research in epilepsy and the different conditions it helps and how to implement the diet. There's a section on other clinical conditions that the diet may be beneficial for, so autism, Alzheimer's disease, brain cancer. And then there's a section that Dominic edited, which is on health, performance, and metabolic alternatives like ketone esters. So I really think that the diet's been used for epilepsy for nearly 100 years now. But I think that some of these other areas like overall health, performance, and disorders like Alzheimer's disease, for which we have really no good treatments, are really going to be the things that are big breakthroughs for a metabolic approach.
Wait, but so, they're seeing some good benefits to with the Alzheimer's.
Yes.
With improving people who are in the early onset and pushing out or delaying onset. In people that are genetically really predisposed to it. So there's definitely a lot of very good work coming on. Do you think the book is going to be good for anybody to read, or do you have to be of a certain level of education for that?
Well, it's probably for the more well-informed. It's really it's an academic book that's written by Oxford Press, which is kind of an academic press. So it's not a popular book, but I think there's so many people in the general public that have become very, very well educated about these topics that I think there's a lot that someone who's interested and well educated about these issues would find a huge treasure trove of, you know, the latest information. We really got all the top people to contribute to the book. But it's not, you're not going to find it on like number one on the New York Times bestseller list. It's not really a money making book, but it's a real resource. I think one of the main benefits is to get all this information in one place. And for people who are advocating for this for health or for their disorder or for their family member, they could say, look, here is like a book. There's like 75 scientists that contributed to this. This isn't me looking on the internet and coming in here with some crazy idea. This is an entire field of research. We have international symposia on this. There's, you know, real science behind it. So I think just for that part, it has a real benefit.
I think it's important people realize you shouldn't just go to a popular blog and read it and say, oh, that's fact.
Right.
People have to put content out every week if they are trying to stay current. And the content they put out is not necessarily beneficial or true per se. It might be what they think is a good idea, but it doesn't mean it's valid. And what you've got there is a collection of actual studies and research papers that are saying, look, these are the actual findings. So I think it's a really, really good reference for sure. You can get it on Amazon, right?
You can get it on Amazon. You can get it at Oxford University Press. Oh my gosh, and I have like a secret code for 30% off that I would tell your readers, but I forgot. This is how what a poor salesman I am.
Okay, so I'll tell you what to do. Send me the email me the code and a link to it, and I'll put that in the show notes. People just click on it and go straight there and they can purchase it if they want. But it's a fantastic thing. I've been aware of it since it came out, and it's definitely a good place to go if you're looking for some very good research. Listen, I'm conscious of time. I know you are a busy lady. So while we're here, anything else that you want to talk through or mention?
Well, the other kind of thing that I'm a real advocate for, besides trying to change our public policies, is I feel like a child that has epilepsy that's being considered for brain surgery should be allowed a trial on the diet first. And if they don't have any metabolic contraindications why they shouldn't go on the diet, I think the parents should be given the information and given that choice. Because the child obviously doesn't have any say in their medical care. But I feel like ethically, it's helped so many children and has had such incredible outcomes where the children are able to go on the diet, stop their seizures, and be medication free and not on a special diet really for the rest of their lives. They should be given that opportunity. So that's, I'm just not sure why that isn't a standard decision tree that should be applied to childhood epilepsy. So that's my other point.
Okay, so we can find out a bit more about you at a site called Scientia, right? You've got that.
Sure. There, you can also go to my Trinity College profile, and the link to the Scientia article is very recent and talks about my laboratory research, particularly my work on autism. Has some great pictures. That's a very good overview, and they can find a lot about me on my Trinity profile.
I'm going to put the link to Trinity College.
Sure.
In the notes as well, and then people can find out I can find your CV as well as your research and everything you've been doing, and the potentially they could get in contact with you.
Yeah.
So be aware, just in case you get a flood of emails about stuff, which would be great if you do, because at least people are listening and can get some sort of help.
Right.
Susan, listen, it's been fantastic having you on. I really appreciate your time today. I would like to see how things pan out in future, and when new research comes up or new things that you become aware of, it'd be great to get you back on and updated on things. And if the microbiome stuff pushes on more, I'd love to be able to discuss that more with you as well, because I think that's going to be, like you say, the next big direction I think people are going to go in.
Yes. Yes. Thank you so much for everything you're doing for health and fitness and brain health.
No, it's been great. So listen, thanks again. And hopefully we'll catch up again soon.
All right. Great. All right. Thank you, Paul.
Take care. Thanks. Bye. All right.